1st, which is the longest day of the year, then the days start getting shorter. I don't know how the days can get shorter, but yet the heat kicks up anyway, but that's another thing. But the days are now getting shorter. And because of that, John the Baptist is born. Why? Because John the Baptist tells us, he must increase and I must decrease. John the Baptist was a very popular preacher of his day. He was one that came, we discussed earlier, in the spirit and power of Elijah, that he would turn back fathers to their sons and sons to their fathers, that he would prepare God's people for the coming of the Messiah. In fact, he was so well known that we were discussing last night that there's actually a little cult that kind of still exists in the world of these sort of followers of John the Baptist, the Mandaeans, who have it. You kind of see them a little bit in the Acts of the Apostles. Paul comes like chapter 8 or 9 or something like that. And he talks about the Spirit. They go, we didn't know there was a Holy Spirit. It was, well, who? By what baptism were you baptized? They said, well, John the Baptist. They didn't know about the baptism of Jesus and the baptism of the Trinity. And so they only know about this baptism of repentance of John the Baptist and not this baptism of the forgiveness of our sins. And so there's still like a little fringe group that kind of exists that, like that somewhere in the Middle East or in Africa that still follow John the Baptist. And this recognition that he must increase and I must decrease, and the same thing occurs in the wintertime. After December 21st or so, the days start getting longer, the sun starts shining more, and Jesus is born. And so he's increasing in the world. And for us, we have to have the same attitude as John the Baptist. Because oftentimes, sometimes in our ministry, we can become prideful. Well, look at all these people that I've proclaimed the gospel to. It often doesn't happen that way, but sometimes it does. Like, you know, and that's another trick of the devil. We could be praying and asking for good things to happen, and maybe you might actually convert your CCD class. Or maybe you're working with this kid, and this kid actually comes back to church and stuff like that. Or you could be like an FBO who goes up hitchhiking and stuff, you know, and meets all these people all along the way, and he might bring people to the gospel. But we should never be prideful of that, just saying, well, thank God that these things are happening, and praise the Holy Spirit. If we start saying, as if this happens, hundreds or thousands are flocking to the Lord because of me, and we see this visa become like, you know, one of those evangelical preachers we see on TV and stuff like that, and they have these mega churches and stuff, and all of that could get into our head, and if it does, then we become prideful, and then the devil wins, because then we think that we're gifted in some way, or they were special, or I have to obey the rules in this instance and stuff like that. It is only through humility that we can achieve the works of the gospel. And so John the Baptist is always very cautious about that. He knows what his role is, he knows what his mission is to prepare for someone greater than me who's going to be coming. I'm not worthy to unstrap his sandals. And we must always be like that before the Lord. In deep humility, seeking his grace all the time. A beautiful opportunity when we look at the truth of the gospel, that we put ourselves as servants, we put ourselves as ministers, and we're just there to serve, not to put glory to ourselves. And John is always pointing out Christ to people. At the beginning of John's gospel, he tells his followers, behold, the Lamb of God, go follow him. Don't look upon me. We must be the same. Mary does that all the time. She never, not like this sort of Protestant criticism that everything reflects upon her, but she always leads us to Jesus. She's always pointing us out to Christ, her son. And we should be the same. Jesus is our Savior. He's our brother. He's our friend. And we share our best friend with everyone. We love him so much. We want everyone to see how great he is, how beautiful he is, how merciful he is, how much he's changed my life. How much better someone else's life could be once we introduce that person to Jesus. So we always take that opportunity whenever we can to speak of Christ, to think with Christ, to love like Jesus and all those we meet, and never to be self-reflective and say, oh, this is all for my efforts, this is all my ministry. It's always the Lord to be ready to, in an instant, to change what we're doing in service to the church, in service to the legion, the certain city you might be in, and say, I'll take that job, I'll take that hard thing. I'll switch my apostle for the next, I mean, the 5 years, I'll do something different. because that's the call of the gospel. Because it's never about me, it's always about him. This day we reflect upon that great truth, that we are always servants. We are always prepared to do the will of the Lord. And like St. John the Baptist, we'll remember August 29th, the end of the summer. Beginning of the summer, we have his birth, and in the summer, we celebrate his martyrdom, proclaiming the truth, even if it costs our lives, or the self-respect of others, or friendships that might have to be put off to the wayside because they conflict with our great love of Christ. This day in this Holy Eucharist, we turn again to the Lord, like John the Baptist, and we remember that he must increase and that we must decrease.